Macmillan Audio presents Rockin' Around the Chickadee by Donna Andrews. Read for you by Bernadette Dunne. Friday, December 20th. Chapter 1. This stupid peace and quiet is killing me. Delaney, my sister-in-law, waved her arms wildly, like a windmill in a tornado. A familiar gesture. I'd seen her do it while pacing up and down like a red-maned tigress, celebrating a victory or venting her frustration over a project gone awry, or while seated at a conference table having a lively discussion with her fellow programmers and techies. But the seated windmill almost always gave way to the pacing version, as if only by covering ground could she cope with overwhelming emotion. Pacing wasn't an option right now, and the windmill looked a little silly when she was lying on the chaise longue in our sunroom, tucked up under a fluffy lavender and pale green afghan, with the soothing strains of an instrumental version of O Little Town of Bethlehem filling the air so softly it was almost subliminal.
"Now, now," my cousin Rose Noire said, "you need to stay calm."
Delaney rolled her eyes and looked at me as if for support. I smiled and nodded. I knew how she felt. How annoying those words were. After 5 months of bed rest, made necessary when her obstetrician had declared her pregnancy high risk, Delaney was thoroughly sick of being told to stay calm and not overexert herself. I'd gone through the same thing for the last month or so of my pregnancy. Not that there had been anything high risk with me, just the fact that twins often came early and bed rest had been the best way of giving Josh and Jamie as much time as possible to grow and mature before they entered the world. Delaney wasn't having twins, just one very large and healthy single baby of as yet unrevealed gender. "The last few days do seem like years," I said. I didn't add my view that maybe it was time to stop torturing her with bed rest. Let her do whatever she felt like doing. It probably wouldn't be much. And let nature take its course. If she gave birth today at 8.5 months, the baby would be in good shape. Even Dad admitted that. But saying it aloud would be heresy, particularly to Rose Noire, who had dedicated the lion's share of her waking moments over the last 5 months to waiting hand and foot on Delaney, and providing just about every known herbal, Wiccan, or New Age remedy for the minor indignities or major perils of pregnancy, at least those that passed muster with Dad and Dr. Waldron. At the moment, Rose Noire had her phone out and appeared to be using it to dial up the volume of the music coming from the little speakers hidden around the room. O Little Town of Bethlehem went from almost subliminal to merely soft.
"I don't know why we had to chase everyone away," Delaney said. "We always have a house full of family and friends for Christmas. This just feels weird and depressing, and there's never anyone to talk to."
"Dad's orders," I said. "He didn't think the usual holiday chaos would be good for you." Delaney sighed loudly. I almost reached for my notebook that tells me when to breathe, as I called my combined calendar and to-do list. But that would probably remind her of her own organizational system, which lived in an app on her phone. Dad hadn't been joking when he ordered her not to open that app for the duration. I decided to wait until I was out of Delaney's sight so I wouldn't remind her of all those lovely neglected tasks and wouldn't have to tell her the task I wanted to jot down. Find someone to talk to Delaney, someone interesting but calm.
At least I've got the chickadees to keep me company, Delaney declared, in a tone that suggested she'd have been completely abandoned if not for her tiny feathered friends. There's no suet out. Don't they like suet? And don't they need it when the weather is this cold? They're very fond of suet, I said, and we ran out this morning, but we're getting another delivery later today. Delivery? Delaney frowned. Carfilly has a suet delivery service now? One of Randall Shifley's former cousins sells very nice organic suet, Rose Noire said, and he's happy to deliver it. Which isn't surprising, I murmured, given the amount of the stuff we go through. In the meantime, do you want me to bring in your laptop? Rose Noire asked. I could set up a Zoom call with your mother. It isn't even 8 a.m. here, Delaney said, which means not even 5 in California. Mom loves me to pieces, but she doesn't want to hear from me in the middle of the night. And if you forgot and did call her this early, she'd probably assume something was wrong and panic, I said. Besides, isn't this the day she's flying out to the East Coast? To visit your aunt and then spend the holidays with us and be here for the birth? Yes, Delaney sighed heavily. She doesn't have time to talk to me today. I'll bring your laptop in anyway, Rose Noire said. You can listen to the birds again. Oh, yes, Delaney's face brightened. And I can try that Merlin app to learn more bird calls. I do have one down. Chickadee-dee-dee, chickadee-dee-dee-dee-dee. Just then my grandmother Cordelia appeared in the doorway. Very nice, she said, but don't go crazy with the extra D's at the end. They only tend to add those in when they're alarmed. She glanced at her wrist, and I deduced this was her subtle way of telling me it was time for us to leave. I'd stay and talk to you, I said to Delaney, but at the moment I have to take Cordelia over to the Carfilly Inn for the conference. Just what is this conference anyway? Delaney's tone was fretful, so I didn't think it was a good time to mention that I'd already explained it to her. Several times. She kept falling asleep in the middle of my explanations. Which meant maybe it would be worth giving another sleep-inducing explanation. Although it would have to be a brief one, Cordelia needed to be at the inn well before 9. My grandmother must have had the same idea. It was Kevin's idea, actually, she said. So another true crime thing? Delaney asked. A good guess. My nephew Kevin was an up-and-coming true crime podcaster. Not exactly, I said. It's designed to provide practical help for people who are working to exonerate someone they believe has been wrongly convicted. Kind of a niche market, isn't it? Delaney frowned at the idea. Not really, I said. Cordelia could rattle off these statistics better than I can. I'm not really that keen on statistics, Delaney shuddered slightly. And I'm not awake enough to recite any right now, Cordelia replied. Just as well, I said. So, I assume that means you won't care if this next bit is approximate. We have something like 2 million people in jail or prison across the country, and experts estimate between 1 and 10% of them are innocent. That's between 20,000 and 200,000 people serving time for something they didn't do. Oh, that's so sad. Delaney clutched her baby bump. Actually, more like a baby mountain these days, as if already trying to protect her unborn child against the perils of unjust incarceration. But good people are busy working to exonerate them, I said, quickly before the tears started. People like our cousin Festus Hollingsworth. His law practice includes a lot of exoneration work. That's so wonderful of him, Rose Noire exclaimed. Delaney nodded and shed a few tears after all, but they looked like happy, sentimental ones. But he can't possibly represent everyone in need of exoneration, Cordelia said. So I suggested we organize a conference to help train other people to do the same thing. And Festus and Kevin thought it was a good idea. especially since we've got so many experts right here in Car Philly. And most of them in the family, I added. In addition to Festus and Kevin, Dad was the local medical examiner, my cousin Horace Hollingsworth was a well-respected CSI, and Grandfather was always happy to talk about the cutting-edge forensic work the J. Montgomery Blake Foundation's DNA lab was doing. We've also got Chief Burke giving pointers on working productively with law enforcement, Cordelia went on, and a couple of actual exonerees who are going to tell their stories.
It sounds so interesting, Delaney said. Wish I could go.
It occurred to me that we might be able to set up a Zoom connection to let her watch a few of the presentations. I made a mental note to ask Kevin. No, maybe I should clear the idea with Dad first to see if he thought true crime would be too stimulating. And I wasn't optimistic. These days, Dad considered Parcheesi and backgammon too stimulating for Delaney.
If we pull this first one off, we might start doing others, Cordelia said, and we could rope you in to talk about tech issues. But for now, we should run.
She glanced at her watch again.
Festus is giving the keynote speech at 9, and I should be there to introduce him. Have a good day.
She nodded to Rose Noire and Delaney and strode out of the room.
I'll see if there's anyone interesting that I could bring home to have dinner with you, I said,
before following Cordelia down the hallway to the rest of the house. When I reached the hall, I glanced through the door of our once and future dining room, now serving temporarily as a bedroom so Delaney wouldn't have to go up and down the stairs. I saw Rob sitting on the foot of the bed, looking glum.
Not bad news, I hope, I said as I stepped into the room.
What?
He started slightly and looked up.
No, not bad news. Not yet, anyway.
And what bad news are you expecting later, then?
I just put in a bid on that house, he said. The one in Westlake.
And are you more worried that you won't get it or that you will? I asked. Rob laughed at that, and the tension on his face eased.
I haven't decided yet, he said. It's certainly not where we saw ourselves living.
I nodded. Westlake was a relatively new neighborhood on the outskirts of Car Philly, an enclave of large, imposing houses in meticulously manicured yards. Rob and I had a running debate on whether the houses there qualified as McMansions. I argued that you couldn't insult a house that way just because it was ostentatiously large, unimaginatively designed, and not that well built. You also needed the obligatory postage stamp yard, and some of the Westlake houses had half an acre. To Rob, they were McMansions, period. The fact that he'd actually put in a bid on a Westlake house showed how desperate he was getting in his search to find a suitable house for him and Delaney and the impending new arrival.
I was really hoping to find something out in the country, Rob said. Big house, big yard, but nothing too fancy or fussy. No traffic, good neighbors. Something a lot like what you and Michael have here.
We have no plans to move, if that's what you're hoping, I said. Sorry about that. I didn't add that we had more than enough spare bedrooms so that he and Delaney, and eventually the new arrival, could stay as long as they liked. He already knew that, as I knew that the impending birth of his son or daughter had fired up some atavistic urge to make a home for his family, a home of their own.
Even if you were moving, it wouldn't be the same, Rob said, because we'd want you guys as neighbors, you and Seth and the Washingtons and the Raffertys, with Mother and Dad close enough that we can see them as often as we want, but they can still go home at the end of the day when the grandkids wear them out. And Westlake won't be so bad. Shorter commute to the office, and,
He'd run out of good things to say about Westlake rather quickly.
That's true, I said. And you've heard me say that the best thing for Westlake would be if we could insinuate a few sane and sensible people into the neighborhood. I just didn't expect you and Delaney to have to be among the ones making the sacrifice.
Yeah.
He chuckled and stood up, pocketing his phone.
Well, keep your fingers crossed.
That the sellers accept your bid?
That whatever would be best in the long run is what actually happens.
Rob sounded uncharacteristically thoughtful.
That we get what we need, not what we think we want. Damn.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.